Blessed evening, church. Welcome back to part three of Getting to Know Mary. I hope you have enjoyed the studies. I hope you've learned certain things, you know, of how the life of Mary. And I'm sure last week's session, I know for some it would have been very tough to take in, but I think there were very key things that we learned from the life of Mary as a mother and the life of Mary and Joseph as parents, and how it's an important role we as parents and maybe you as a mother play in your child's life, right? So today also we're going to see on our third part on getting to know Mary. See, in our previous one, we looked at the mother of the Messiah, but now, and how seriously she took her responsibility as being that mother of the Messiah. Everything she taught the child, everything she did, the principles she had in life and all that, she took it very seriously, the role that she was playing of the mother of the Messiah, right? And so today what we're going to do, we're going to reflect on the threefold blessing from Elizabeth and how she was the only woman in history to be a seed bearer. We were inspired by an example of a good character, right? A godly mother who walked off the Lord, right? So today also what we're going to learn is we're going to learn on the sufferings of Mary, right? So last week we learned on Mary, the mother of the Messiah, and then about the threefold blessing. So today we're going to learn about the sufferings of Mary. Had to endure as a part of the role that she had to play. So she, even though she took on that role and responsibility of being the mother of the Messiah, there was a time where she had to go through times of suffering, and that role also she took on herself, right? Okay, so let's get into the study. Okay, so Mary, the silent sufferer. There's one title you can call Mary as well, is right? She's a mother of the Messiah. This one as well, the silent sufferer, right? So as human beings, we have tendency to either react or respond to a situation. See, when faced with adverse situations, the heart and heartbreaking moments, Mary was more the type that responded to these things while enduring pain and rather reacting with emotional outbursts. Now, if I ask you, when such situations happen, are you a reactor or are you a responder? You might ask me, Pastor, what is the difference? Now, reaction is something quick, it's spontaneous, it suddenly happens without knowledge. Right? For example, when you touch something hot, you react. Bang, you react. Responding is you wait, you think, and then you say something. When you get angry, do you react or do you respond? Right? The initial thing, normally what happens is we react very quickly. But we look at Mary's life, everything she went to, you wouldn't find in scripture where she reacted. She always responded. All right? So there were instances in her life where she would silently ponder and keep things in her heart. And then again, there are other moments where she would just break down and weep without blaming or cursing anyone, but willing to endure that pain as a part of her mission. Being the silent sufferer was really hard because it was also part of the prophecy that was spoken over her life. And therefore, it was she who had to face the agony when the fulfillment of that prophecy came to pass. All right? So Mary birthed and raised her son, knowing fully well that she was raising the Lamb of God. She knew exactly who she was raising. She knew it was not something new to her. And she knew that she was birthing the Lamb of God who was going to take the sin away from the world. Right? So she raised her precious son to be the ultimate Passover lamb that would be sacrificed. She knew that Jesus was going to be the ultimate Passover lamb. And she brought him up in that manner. From the day she conceived Jesus right up to his death, Mary had to endure the knowledge of this pain and go through this knowing that it was required of her. Just because it was going to be a painful experience, she did not refuse to endure it. Imagine the mental and emotional agony that the mother of the Savior had to endure all her life. And that too, bearing in awe in her heart without regretting the choice she had made to be the handmaiden of the Lord. She made a choice. Even though she knew these were things she was going to go through, She took on that choice and she took on that responsibility. What a beautiful thing about Mary, right? Mary did the will of the Lord out of pure love. Mary didn't advertise her pain to get attention, right? Neither did she wallow in self-pity and succumb to a heartache. Instead, she held on to God, courageously trusting in the fact that she was blessed above all women. She made God her strength and her refuge in the face of all her suffering and sought comfort in Him alone. She trusted God. We saw that in part one. When the news came to Mary, how she just took on that responsibility and trusted God, not knowing what the consequences are going to be. She just said yes. Bold, brave. She knew God will have her back. So we're going to look into the scripture reading today, Luke chapter 2, verses 21 to 38. Luke chapter 2, verses 21 to 38. If we turn in our Bibles to Luke chapter 2, verses 21 to 38. My mistake. Sorry, Luke chapter 2, verses 21 to 38. So it'll come up on your screens as well. And when 8 days were completed for the circumcision of the child, his name was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. Now when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were completed, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. And it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who opens the womb shall be called holy unto the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was just a devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord Christ. So it came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. Then Simon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign which will be spoken against. Yes, a sword will pierce through your own soul also, and the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Now there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age and had lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity. And this woman was a widow of about 84 years who did not depart from the temple, but served God with fasting and prayers night and day. And coming in that instant, she gave thanks to the Lord and spoke of him to all those who looked for redemption in Jerusalem. All right. So we see in this scripture, we see Jesus being presented at the temple 8 days after his birth. Since Jesus was Mary's firstborn, he was referred to as holy and set apart unto the Lord. Mary was already familiar with this because it was according to the law. Both she and Joseph were very devout parents who were obedient to the laws of God and kept the commandments of the Lord. After having made their humble offering, usually a parent who takes their child to a man of God for prayer would like to hear a good prophetic word. All right? So this is after they had made their offering, they hear Simeon's prophecy. And normally, all of us love to hear something good, isn't it? Yeah, that's what you see. A prophecy comes into you, man, it's encouraging. When you come to dedicate your child, you want the pastor to speak something good over the child, isn't it? And give a good prophetic word, right? But if you look at this, they were probably wanted to hear how prosperous he's going to be, or how this child is going to do some great things and all that, right? Because that's what parents like to rejoice and boast about. Oh yes, my son was prayed over, and this is what was spoken over his life and all those things, right? But this was not the case for Mary and Joseph. It was a prophecy both of joy and sorrow. There were two things in that prophecy. There was joy in it, but there was also sorrow in it. See, old Simeon was eagerly waiting for his Savior with love and expectation to see him. God did not let Simeon see death until he had held the Messiah of Israel in his hands and prophesied over him. Simeon not only prophesied that Jesus would be the consolation of Israel, but also that he would be the light to the Gentiles. Simeon spoke both that, right? He talked about Jesus being the light to the Gentiles as well. He prophesied that while some of the people of Israel would believe that Jesus was the consolation of Israel, some others would not believe so. They wouldn't. They only thought, no, he's only for them. No, but he was there. Simeon spoke that. He said that Jesus would face much opposition in the future. Simeon also said that Jesus would reveal the truth, even the deep things of the heart. Finally, Simeon prophesied over Mary, saying that her sword would pierce her own soul. In other words, Jesus' suffering would cause Mary much pain and grief personally. This definitely was not an easy prophecy for Mary to handle. For that moment, Mary would have thought, what is this sword that is going to pierce my soul? Isn't it? See, in the early years of the Messiah's life, we see that there were three significant moments when Mary silently pondered about things in her heart. What Mary actually did was she treasured all these moments in her heart silently and reflected on them deeply in the days ahead. See, when something like that is spoken over us, what is the first thing you and I do? We'll find someone and go and tell, you know, this is what this pastor spoke over me. This is what he told. You know, but sometimes it's good to just ponder things in the heart and just keep it and see, you know, Lord, what is this? Take it to God first. Ask the Lord to confirm whatever has been spoken over your life. Good or bad, take it to God. See, in the first account is found in Luke chapter 1 verse 29. If you look at Luke chapter 1 verse 29, see the first account of Mary pondering things in her heart. And coming in that instant, she gave thanks to the Lord and spoke of him to all those who looked. No, not this one. Luke chapter 1. Yes. But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting was this. On the first account, Mary was troubled in her heart, wondering at the manner in which the angel Gabriel greeted her. She was troubled. Oh man, why? What is this? Man, that's such a big thing. The second account of Mary treasuring up her things in her heart is found in Luke chapter 2, verse 19. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. This is what he's talking about, is what Simeon spoke over her life. All right? No, this is not what Simeon spoke of. This is everything what happened, of what took place, of the shepherds and all that coming. And you know, everything, she kept it and pondered it in her heart. When the shepherds visited baby Jesus in Bethlehem, we find Mary pondering at the reaction of the shepherds, the way they gave glory to God and went about spreading the good news of the Savior's birth. So for her, it was something. You know, the shepherd, the way they came and the glory, they gave so much glory about God. And those things, Mary pondered it in her heart. Right? Mary treasured these things in her heart, realizing how special her little baby was. And then the third occasion that Mary deeply pondered was when Jesus was 12 years old and had gone missing. All right. If we read further down in the scripture, we all know about the part where Jesus is taken to now and where he is gone into the temple, and he was missing. All right. So Mary and Joseph returned to Jerusalem to find him in the temple court, sitting in the midst of religious leaders. He was listening to them and asking them questions as well. All those present were amazed at Jesus' wisdom and understanding. Everyone there were very learned people who were seated in the temple. And they were amazed at the knowledge this 12-year-old boy carried. They've been studying and studying, and these are people who are very well learned and so advanced and mature. But still, this 12-year-old boy was speaking so much great knowledge, right? And when Mary came and, you know, we looked at them and was finding Jesus, right? And Jesus was questioned by Mary, "Why did you look for me? Didn't you know I had to be about my father's business?" Mary was practically speechless. Jesus was a 12-year-old, was reminding his mother that he had come of age to be recognized as the son of the commandment. In other words, it was time for him to have his bar mitzvah. All right. So what is this bar mitzvah? Bar mitzvah, this is where, in the presence of elders and religious leaders, a boy of 12 is acknowledged as an adult in the community, where he is responsible for his own actions and is ready to serve. All right. So if you read in Luke chapter 2 verse 51, you find out what? Mary treasuring up this entire scenario in her heart and contemplating on it. Everything happening, you see, Mary is just pondering things, treasuring it up in her heart. She's not blurting it out. She's not going haywire. She's not going over or off the hook. No, she's pondering it in her heart. Everything that's taking place. All right. Mary was not a busybody, a gossip, or someone who went about boasting. She was very gentle, simple and humble. A person unassuming in all her ways. She was also very wise in knowing to keep silent and think about things. You know, the biggest issue sometimes we have is to keep silent. We think we always have to be very verbal. But you know, there are times we have to be silent. Certain things that take place, ponder on it, take it to God, be silent. Right? Mary's silent pondering was an act of her quiet and confident faith in God in preparing for what the future had in store for her. The moment we get very verbal, "Ayyo, you don't know what I'm going through, man." Isn't that what happens? Anything we go through, suddenly what happens? We'll go to that person in church, "Ane, pray for me. You have no idea what I'm going through. Everything is falling apart," and blah, 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 and you start telling. Instead, being silent and trusting God is handling this. You know, this week when we were in our discipleship group, we studied about the wilderness experience. We were studying on the seven stages. We are doing a study on the seven stages of Jesus, and we were doing on temptation and the wilderness, the 40 days Jesus was in the wilderness, and we were relating it to what does it feel for us now to be in a wilderness. Sometimes the wilderness is the most loneliest experience, where it's only you and God, no one else. And for Mary, she just trusted in God. Everything that was happening, she's very calm. Right? She was not hot-headed, but she was able to handle those things. That is a great quality we as parents, we as mothers need to ask. Certain things in life happen, but how do we handle it? Do we take it to God, pray about it, not blow your head about it, not go blabbering about it to everyone? Being quiet in His presence is very important. All right? So, see, the notable feature about Mary is that she silently endured all kinds of hardships through Messiah's life. Sometimes we don't see that. We think, but look at as a mother, what she had to go through. So many things. But she just kept them in her heart. And she went through all that. After the birth of Jesus, Mary and Joseph had to go to Egypt to protect the child from King Herod. She suffered in silence, knowing that it was a fulfillment of prophecy. Then again, we find Mary anxiously looking for her little son who got lost when he was 12 years of age. And finally found him in the temple, seated among wise and learned men. As a mother, she was naturally worried and anxious of her beloved child and would not give up until she had found him safe and sound. That's what a mother would do. Finally, Mary had to go through the ultimate of agony that tore her soul like a sword, actually piercing her heart when she saw her darling son badly beaten, bruised, and carrying that heavy cross on his shoulder all the way to Calvary, bathed in blood. Mary's heart was shattered when she saw that. Her precious little boy crucified and hanging on that cross. As a mother, you have children. How would you like to see that happen to your child? Even if you knew that is what they are called to do, it's hard for a mother to see that happen. See, right before her very eyes, she saw her son dying in utter pain, humiliation, and agony. Which mother could endure such things? Worst of it all was when God, from whom she found her strength in, had also turned his face away from his only begotten son. There was no one to whom Mary could appeal on behalf of her dear son. There was no one in whom. There was no one. She just had to go through that terrible anguish as a mother so that others could have salvation through her son. She had to go through that pain of seeing her son go through all this. Why? So that others will benefit from what is going to take place. See, in the natural, if such a thing happened, I'm sure any mother who loves her son would ask, why does it have to be my son? But in the case of Mary, she could not even say that because her calling was a painful one. Finally, when Mary held the lifeless body of her son in her lap, just imagine what it must have been like for her to have to go through all of this. While in anguish, shattered, and with no husband by her side, she felt all alone and broken. Mary might have even dreaded the day that prophecy would come to pass. But when God speaks, no man can reverse it. Indeed, a sword had pierced Mary's heart the day she beheld her precious son and offered as a supreme and ultimate sacrifice for the sin of all mankind. See, for Mary, she had no one to pull into, no shoulder to cry on. So it makes us think, what pain and agony Mary went through. And that is the very prophecy Simeon spoke when they came to dedicate the child in the temple. So let's go at a bit of historical background. Mary and Joseph dedicating baby Jesus at the temple on the eighth day and presenting the humblest offering given by the poor shows that the Magi, the wise men, had not visited them as of yet. If they had visited the infant, then the parents would have offered something of greater value. It is clear that the Magi visited Jesus when he was about 2 years of age. Now, all our nativity scenes, what do we have? The three wise men coming to the manger. But in actual scripture, it was only the shepherds who came to the manger. The wise men visited Jesus when he was 2 years of age, not at the manger. It was at his hometown in Nazareth. All right? So this understanding must have been based on the three gifts presented. All right? So sometimes the Bible doesn't specifically say that there were only three wise men. But all of us say it's three wise men. Why? It's because of the three gifts. But there could have been many wise men who came, but bearing three particular gifts. Right? I don't know how many of you now are messed up with your Christmas story. All right? Everyone thinks, we three kings of Orient. You may have heard the song. You have the nativity scene that comes. We have the three kings that come. But actually, they never came to the manger. The three kings did not come to the manger. It doesn't mention three specific kings. It says wise men, but they bought three gifts. All right? All right. So, however, it is more likely that many wise men visited Christ's child since he was going to be the light to the Gentile nation. Right? So, some people say from the many tribes and the nations, from all the nations, the wise men came bearing these three types of gifts. The boy Jesus, questioning Mary about the requirements of the law, was clear that Mary was well versed in the scripture, and it was expected of her to understand all that needed to be done according to the expected time in Christ's life. So Mary knew scripture. She had studied the scriptures. So when Jesus spoke things, she exactly knew what he was saying. See, Joseph's absence at the death of Jesus gives us an indication that Mary might have been a widow at this time. I'm not 100% saying, but this is what theologians also believe. Because Joseph was not present at the death of Jesus, right? So they believe that Mary was a widow at that time Jesus died. This may account for the reason that the Lord Jesus entrusted his mother to the care of John, his closest disciple. That's why he entrusted Mary to John to look after, because she didn't have anyone. She was a widow by that time. All right? So, truth revealed. Another prophetess and Simeon, who was just and a devout man, right, were both well advanced in years. They were very of old age. They were quite old. All right? They both were righteous people. They were both people of prayer. They were filled with the Holy Spirit and who held on to the promises of God and would not see death until they had seen the promise fulfilled. So they were waiting for that promise to come through. Just as God chose Mary and Joseph, both who were righteous, to be the earthly parents of our Lord Jesus Christ, God also chose Simeon and Anna to be the ones who would declare a prophecy and blessing over the Savior. How did these two precious people know that Jesus was the promised Messiah? How do you think? See, Simeon and Anna were both well versed in Bible prophecy. They were people who read and studied the scripture eagerly, looking forward to the Messiah. Both of them were people of prayer and worshippers. They fasted to hear the voice of God and to be divinely directed. They studied times and seasons to understand and know the move of God. Both were filled with the Holy Spirit so much that they knew the exact time that Jesus would be presented at the temple. And the Holy Spirit directed them both to come to the temple at the same time Jesus was brought in. You can't say that is coincidence. No. That is the Holy Spirit at work. Though they were well advanced in years, yet their spiritual eyes and ears were active and attentive to the leading of the Holy Spirit. So if you are watching today and you think you are well advanced in years, that doesn't stop you from the Holy Spirit using you and speaking to you. Don't undermine yourself. You still can be very powerful, used by the Holy Spirit of God. See, They had studied the times and seasons of Bible prophecy and looked forward to the promised Messiah with great expectation. See, since the shepherds spread the good news, they would have even heard about the Savior's birth. Right? The shepherds were the first people who spread the good news of Jesus' birth. Therefore, the moment they saw baby Jesus, they knew that the prophesied Emmanuel was in their midst. They knew it. Simeon and Anna were simple people. Simeon was a righteous man and Anna was a widow and a prophetess. Both of them were people of great faith. They were like Abraham and Sarah of Jesus' time. They both believed that God would fulfill his promise. They knew. They knew that they were not going to see death until they see the Messiah. And they believed and they trusted God. What is the promise God has given you? And you feel, you know, I'm going old of age. I don't see it being fulfilled. Are you going to still believe and trust God that his word is going to be true? He's going to bring it to pass. So what are we going to learn? What are we going to learn? What are some life lessons we can learn from today's session? Number one. As a parent, especially as a mom, when you know that you have to deal with a difficult child from birth, how would you handle it? The child may be born with a deformity or a disease or some sort of physical or mental setback, which might require you to face a lot of struggles, battles, and embarrassments. Sometimes you may not even know whether the child will live long. Yet, would you endure taking care of that child with love or just walking away saying, I'm not going to let this child be a hindrance to me in my life? What are you going to do as a parent? God has entrusted that child in your hands. What are you going to do? You're going to endure all that hardship? Trust God? Because God trusted you to give that child, knowing that you'll be the perfect person to look after that child. God knew he could not give that child to anyone else. No one else will do what you can do. God has so much confidence in you. But do you have confidence in you? Secondly, when dedicating your children to the Lord, do you also dedicate them to Christian service? Are you raising your children to study and qualify in some field of career? Do you also train them to be involved in ministry from their childhood days? I see a lot of parents pushing them on careers and all those things. But getting involved in ministry, getting involved in church things, it always is a second option, never a priority. But when you instill that into the child and, you know, get involved, go, do something for God. Oh, something is coming. Get involved. Go do this. I'll come and drop you. I'll pick you up. Get involved. What happened? The child is growing up with that. Getting into ministry. Serving God in his temple. Serving God in his house. It's very important. We all love to dedicate our children to the Lord. We love a blessing from God. But do we dedicate them to serve God in his house? Do we say, Lord, let him serve you? I will go through anything, but I will make sure he serves you, God. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. A beautiful statement. That should be our motto. As parents, as fathers, as the head of the home, what are your principles you're setting? Thirdly, there might have been many sacrifices that we as parents might have made in raising our children. And we might have undergone many hardships along by doing so. I know of many of you have gone through many hardships in bringing up your children, in educating them, and in where they are right now. They don't know what difficulties you had to go through to bring them here. but like Mary, never grumbled or complained, but had faith. Are you also earnestly praying in faith and asking God to make your child's life a testimony to touch many lives? Instead of grumbling and telling people, they don't know what I went through. I had to give up all these things. But instead of grumbling, instead of complaining, would you have faith that, you know, God is going to use them, they are going to touch many other lives? That is what you have to have. Number four, have you received a difficult prophecy over your life and rejected it because you wanted nice things spoken over you, or you have changed your lifestyle to take that difficult prophecy as a challenge and live for God like Mary did? I don't know if you have received a difficult prophecy, if you have received something that you couldn't hear, that you didn't want to hear. What have you done with it? Have you taken it up like Mary as a challenge, trusting God? It's hard to take difficult prophecies, isn't it? It's easy to take good prophecies. But I want to encourage you, take it on as a challenge. Take it to God. Ask God to give you that confidence, give you that ability to push through this. Number five, like Simeon and Anna, are you being led by the Spirit in all the decisions you make? Or are you saying you don't hear from God anymore? Probably because you've turned old age, you know, you're saying, I'm done with ministry, Pastor. I've done what I need to do. No. You cannot never say, you cannot take a back seat in ministry. There is no timeouts. There is no breaks in serving God. Oh, no, Pastor, I need a break, Pastor. Pastor will give you a break. But in the Lord's service, we don't have breaks. We don't have timeouts. We serve God until our last breath. We obey God until our last breath. So, whatever age you are at, it doesn't matter. God can use you mightily. I want to encourage you. I know many, many elderly people watching today. You're thinking, you know, what can I do? I can't. No, God can use you if you are willing to listen. If Anna and Simeon were able to be used by God and hear God's voice and be led by the Holy Spirit, you too can be. Don't shut yourself away from being able to hear God. Ask God to speak to you. Ask God to use you mightily. In your community, in your prayer group, wherever you are placed, ask God. Let the Holy Spirit lead you and for you to do mighty things for them. Number six, have you reached old age and given up on life? Or are you like Simeon and Anna, studying the word, fasting, praying and hearing from the Lord and being a blessing to many? Do that. Don't give up. Number seven, do you honestly believe in the promises of God and wait for them to be fulfilled in your life? Or have you given up claiming the promises of God and believing in them? Have you given up on the promises God has given you because it's taken so long? Have you given up on everything that God has spoken of your life? Maybe a good prophecy that came to you, you've given up because you've been waiting, you're not seeing any results. Simeon and Anna were waiting till their old age. But because of their relationship with God and their relationship with their Holy Spirit, what happened? They knew. The Holy Spirit led them at that time. They waited in faith, knowing God is a prayer answering God. God is not going to go back on His word. So whatever God has spoken over your life, whatever God has said, His promises will always be fulfilled. Believe that, church. Just as Simeon and Anna were awaiting the Messiah, are you prayerfully and eagerly awaiting His return? I know we've been learning a lot about the church and Israel and the clock and all that pastor's been teaching us. And even previously, there have been so many studies that were done. But are you eagerly waiting for his return? Or are you saying, you know, Jesus is coming, Jesus is coming. Yes, yes, I've been hearing that from when I was a child. But are you waiting eagerly or have you given up on that? You know what? I don't think he's coming. Eagerly wait. Look forward to his second coming. So church, as we finish this part on part three on getting to know Mary, I hope you learned something today. I hope you will take what was shared today and, you know, whatever you're going through, maybe you're a parent watching and, you know, you've got a difficult child. Teachers come and say things, doctors say things, and you don't know what to do. But I want to encourage you, will you hold on to the promises of God? What was spoken over that child? Don't go with what people tell you. Don't go with what your school teacher tells you. Don't go with what the principal tells you. Don't go with what the doctors tell you. Oh, they've got so many red flags. Be careful. This is what he needs to go for, this therapy, that therapy. They'll tell all sorts of things. But say, no, I believe God said at this particular age, he's going to be fine. That's what I'm going to believe on. When he turns this is how he's going to be. This is what I'm going to believe on. I'm not going to believe on anything else. So I want you, because I'm speaking out of experience. I want you to believe in the promises God has given you. Endure that hardship. Endure that negativity spoken. Push through it. Don't let it affect your mind. Hang on to the promises of God. Because God, when he speaks something, he's never a liar to his word. His word will always accomplish whatever is spoken. It will never go back void. It will fulfill what it has to fulfill. I want you to believe that. Whatever promise God has given you, I want you to believe. Just because maybe you've been waiting for so long. Maybe you're watching and you say, no, I'm waiting for my own home. I'm waiting and waiting. I don't see anything happen. You've given up? No. Believe. Say, no, God said he's going to do it. He will do it. Have that faith. Push through. Push through. Just ponder it. Don't go talking and blabbering about it to everyone. Keep things in your heart. Keep it between you and God. That is it. No one else needs to know. And God will do the needful. The moment is what happens is when we open our mouth and start blabbering a lot of things, God can't work then. Because what happens is we start putting our trust in man. Why we blabber? So that man will help us. Why we tell? So that man can help us. But when you keep it silent, when you keep it between you and God, then God can work. Then God will work. And then you definitely know it is God, not man. So don't wait for man to open a door for you. Let God open a man's heart to open that door for you. For that to happen, keep things with you, in your heart, between you and God. And let God work. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this time. We thank you, Lord, for teaching us, Lord. Thank you, God, for Mary's life and what we can learn from her, Lord. We thank you for the amazing woman of God that she was, Lord. How she went through so many hardships. So many things she kept in her heart, Lord, trusting you, holding on to you, holding on to the calling, the responsibility that she took off. She didn't ever let go that responsibility, Father. Until the very end, she pulled through, God. Lord, give us that faith, God. Give us that ability as parents, as mothers, to pull through every hardship. I specifically pray, Lord, for parents who are having children who are struggling, God. And they're getting complaints over complaints with teachers, doctors, And sometimes they're in a fix, don't know what to do, Lord. Lord, give them the wisdom they need to pull through, God. Help them to hold on to the promises of you, God. Help them to believe that this child was a gift given to them. That you have their future in your hands, Lord. And that you have to do something great in their lives, Father. I pray, God, that you will give parents the boldness to stand on the truth of the word, to believe in what you say, God. Also pray, Lord, for every other person who's viewing. Lord, who have, you know, thought, you know, God cannot use me. God cannot speak to me. I don't hear the voice of God. Lord, right now I pray that you will open their inner ears, Lord, to hear you. I pray, God, that your voice will be heard, that you will lead them, you will guide them. Use them mightily, Father, to be a blessing to many people. The people they meet on a day-to-day basis. The people in their care group or wherever they meet, God. In their neighbors. Lord, use them. Holy Spirit, lead them. Speak to them. To be a blessing to many, God. I thank you, God, for what you're going to do. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you for tuning in this evening, on a Friday evening, and listening to this word. I hope you are blessed. I hope to catch you again next week for part number 4 on getting to know Mary. See you next week. Beautiful.